of the continuation of what has always existed in Mali. Keep in mind that the overthrow of Ibeka, as we call him, was premised on legislative elections that did not go down well with popular Malian, if you'd call it, reviews, to the extent that the N5 movement sprang up, there was mass protest, and that led to his exit. So then you begin to see a pattern. As long as there is no good governance, it creates an environment that makes it very difficult to have the type of democratic leverage to respond effectively to the type of conflicts that are going on in Mali. So you have in the central part of Mali around the Gao region, the conflicts that are inter-ethnic, but predominantly between agriculturists and farmers. Then you had the Tuareg rebellion, in which the Malian government from Bamako had to negotiate, and that ended with the Algiers Accord, but that accord has not been implemented. And to that extent, governance becomes a very key component of how you also deal with terrorism and the spread of violent extremism that continues to ravage the Sahel. And so it is these, what you would call weaknesses in political governance, that would manifest itself again in this second coup. But the thing that is at the advantage of our leaders is that this is not the first time they'll be dealing with such matters. So I'm hopeful that the extraordinary summit would continue to hold Mali together in support so that they move forward and reestablish constitutional order.
Talking about holding Mali together, now plans and strategies need to be employed to see to the stability that you're wishing for. For France, for instance, the President Emmanuel Macron has said that they are going to cut off aid to Mali. The UN spends not less than $1 billion annually to save crisis in Mali. What do you think we need to do, even as this extraordinary summit is about to begin, plans and strategies that need to be employed, Prof?
Yeah, so first of all, you have painted the picture in which our global community is now completely intolerant of regimes that are military-led. But I would want to bring it back closer home. This is already our own norm setting at the level of the economic community of West African states. Because we saw it at first hand in the civil wars that were ravaging West Africa and literally threatening the stability of the entire region. So what you see happening is our leaders gradually and persistently evolved a political governance system across West Africa when we talk about peace and security. And that collective responsibility of all of West Africa to respond to any threat in a country that becomes a threat to the entire region is what has emerged in two major protocols. And those two protocols, the supplement of which is the 2001 protocol on democracy and good governance, is what is currently operational. And so our West African leaders would insist that it doesn't matter the challenges Mali is facing, you cannot have a military regime leading Mali. And that is in the interest of the Malians themselves. Because once you have an agreement and the type of right compromises, and we saw that in 2015 in Burkina Faso, when Blaise Compaoré had to flee and leave office, there was a transitional charter and there was an interim government led by President Michel Kafando. Yeah, the military participated. Prime Minister became Lieutenant Colonel Yakubu Zida. But that was able to carry Burkina Faso back into elections. And it is one of the performing democracies at this time in West Africa.
Is that the change we want to see?
Yes. So so your question is, so what are they going to do? Because the crisis has been accentuated by the second coup d'etat, the West African leaders will want to be assured that the transition, which is governed by a transitional charter, is uninterrupted, and that the role of the civilians in government will not be diminished, and that the timetable for that transition, which is basically leading to elections in February 2022, will be respected. Mm. And they will do this knowing very well that it's not enough to say that, and here I'm talking about the current interim president, Assimi Goïta. It's not for him, it's not enough for him to tell our leaders that I will respect the timetable and elections will be held. The West African leaders would want to hold him accountable to a monitoring system that ensures that the elections take place. And that is why former President Goodluck Jonathan, who is the lead mediator of ECOWAS, goes there frequently, with, of course, the support of our own foreign minister, Honorable Shelley Ayoko Bochue, who is the chair of the Mediation and Security Council of ECOWAS, and for that matter, West Africa. And so the mechanisms are there, and I think that they only are activating what they know already and insisting, which then concludes with the key question that you raised. If this then is in place, the urgent need for financial support, not to mention humanitarian support, so that Mali can continue to survive, can continue uninterrupted. And keep in mind that when these funds are taken away, the people who will suffer more are the ordinary men and women, a majority of them women and children. And so we want a situation in which you don't exacerbate what is already happening in that region, which is very dire. And to that extent, it's in the interest of Mali for that international support to continue to come. But that can only happen when West African leaders endorse a regime that is not a military regime, even if military personnel will participate in it.
Mr. Bombade, we have to end our discussion here. Definitely, we'll get in touch with you more, as we know that a statement is supposed to be brought out at the end of this summit. We'll definitely come and see if some of the plans that you actually outlined right here has been put in place during the summit. But we are grateful for your time this afternoon. I was speaking with Emmanuel Bombade. He is a senior mediation advisor, the former Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs and Regional Integration, and he's also an international relation expert.